asking for in giving a wide breadth of activities to kids. The top things we see are opportunities for physical activity, homework assistance, access to beverages, snacks, and in some cases meals, opportunities for reading and writing, and science, technology, engineering, and math learning opportunities as well. This is the national list that you see on the screen. If we look here in Allegheny County, we see the top things very similar in order are physical activity, access to academic programs and clubs, science, technology, engineering, and math learning opportunities, access to meals and snacks, and then music and art kind of leaps up a little bit over some of the other items here locally. So again, parents are really satisfied. This number is 92% here, and they're satisfied with a lot of different aspects of their programs, many of which are the kinds of things they were looking for in their kids' program. So moving on to support. So this is where we look at whether or not parents actually think that the public should be helping to support after-school programs, right? And whether or not it's a good use of public dollars to ensure that all children have access to quality after-school programs. And we can see nationally that more than 8 in 10 parents with children in after-school programs agree that the programs help working parents keep their jobs. You can also see that 84% of parents support public funding for programs. And if we look at those numbers here in Allegheny County, we see that 86% of parents here locally support public funding for after-school programs. So that's mostly happy news we talked about. I want to just talk a little bit about the challenges that face us nationally. And because of the sample size here, I can't give you details on this specific to Allegheny County, but I think we can be sure that many of these same challenges carry over here locally as well. So as I mentioned before, the demand is really greatest among low-income and minority families, where we have participation in after school and unmet demand are much higher among children from low-income households than we see among children from higher-income households. We also see that the parents of African-American children and Hispanic children would enroll their program if a program were available at much higher rates than the parents of white children. We see that half of non-participants from low-income families would participate in a program if a program were available to them. We also find that low-income parents are more likely to cite cost as a barrier to their participation and issues around transportation, so lack of a safe way to get to and from programs as a concern that parents have for participation. And then we find that nearly half of Hispanic and African American parents who would like their child in a program report that the fact that there are no programs available in their community is a reason why they're not enrolled in programs. So just a little more detail on the cost. I mentioned that that's a barrier, in particular in low-income households. Over the 10 years, we've seen the cost of after-school programs, this is national data again, the cost of after-school programs has gone up from $55 per week to $114 per week. Average that parents report out. These are inflation adjusted, so these are all 2014 dollars. It's not a shift in dollars. And half of parents of after-school participants agree that the current economic conditions have made it difficult for them to afford placing their kids in after-school programs. So we know we have challenges here. I mean, I think one of the things I think about when I look at this slide, though, is all the growth that's happened in the field, right? All the work that you all have been doing here locally, all been doing nationally to ensure that programs are of higher quality than they were in 2004. So I don't think this is just an issue where you're deciding, oh, we need to raise our rates, right? We need to raise our rates because we need to pay our staff more. We need to make sure that our staff have benefits in many cases. We need to make sure that our staff have the opportunities for professional development that we know they need. We need a wide variety of activities that we know from the data that parents are looking for. So many of the costs on your end are clear to me, but I think the point that many people don't get is that those costs in many cases are transferring over to parents. Most parents pay for their after-school opportunities is what we found in the survey. Only a quarter of parents say that their after-school opportunities are offered for free. So most parents are paying, and they're paying at about $114 per week nationally. The number's actually higher here in Allegheny County. again, it's a smaller sample size, so there's gonna be more flex in sort of exactly how much higher that number is, but we can tell from sort of the national picture and from the state picture that it's still a significant investment for many families to help ensure that their kids are in after school. So just a couple little takeaways here. We've obviously seen progress nationally over the years. There are more kids in after school. There are more kids who would be in programs if programs were available. So I feel like we've been building some public will for programs where parents are beginning to see this as an expectation, right? That learning shouldn't end at 3 o'clock. And if it does, that sort of trouble is often what comes along with that. So it's more kids are in programs, more parents are seeing programs as an expectation. Support for programs is really strong, and support for public funding for programs is strong. Parents value their programs for a wide variety of reasons. I didn't talk about this today, but you can see on our website, we ranked the states, the top 10 states for after school across the country. And if you look at that list of states, often those are states that have public investment at the state level in after school programs. And I think you might see that playing out a little bit here with the Allegheny County numbers being so much higher, because you also have public investment here, you have foundations that are supporting your work, you've got a system of folks that are working together to help ensure that more kids have access. So there are a lot of different factors that kind of come to play in helping ensure that kids are able to participate in after school. And obviously we have opportunity gaps that remain at the national level, at the state level, and here locally. We also have more information that's forthcoming. So for those of you that have mobile devices, you can check out online. We actually have an interactive data dashboard that we just this morning uploaded Allegheny County data to. Can dig even more deeply into the data than what you have on that fact sheet in front of you and what I just shared with you. We have the fact sheet that you see here. We also have African American and Hispanic fact sheets available. Those are national as opposed to locally. And then we have additional special reports that are coming in 2015 on science, technology, engineering, and math, on physical activity, on access to summer programs. So summer is a separate strand of questions in the survey. And then we're looking at doing a special report on communities of concentrated poverty. So I want to just close by saying you all have been doing amazing work here. I am excited to think about the potential of doing an additional sample here in Allegheny County in 2019, right? And seeing how far your data come in those 5 years. And then again in 2024, as you continue your systems building work and your quest to make sure that all kids here locally have access to after school programs. Thanks, everyone.